All right. Hey, everybody. Hey, Alex, how you doing?
How's it going, Dan?
Awesome, man. Good to see you. Good to see you. This is our first recording for 2023, and I'm pumped to be hanging out. So welcome back to PalletSide Chat. We're pumped to be continuing on with this. And we figured what better place to start the year than with a bit of a recap of what happened in November and December, hey? So, give me the 30-second overview. Was it a total cluster? We talked about it before peak last year. We did an episode on kind of lessons learned. You had some pretty good stories, but how did it go this time for you?
Let's just say we're picking this up at the end of January. Completely my fault, because peak was a shell shock. I had to crawl back out of my hole and recover a little bit. So
fair enough. I saw Alex in December. Our paths crossed briefly at a warehouse, and I could tell you were running on pure adrenaline, which I think is the theme of peak for every operator. So congrats on being done. And I know just from chatting with you before recording today that there's some cool stuff that went on. So what I was thinking for today was that we could maybe go back. And when we talked about prepping for peak, there was kind of three big buckets. Like, we talked about team and your people, and how important they are. We talked about just process and operations and how preparation is kind of the key to having a really great peak. And then we also talked about carriers and how important clearly they are. They close the connection between your warehouse and your customers. So I was thinking maybe today we could look at those three buckets, you know, and I'd love to hear from you. You know, you gave us some great tips and advice. I'd love to hear how some of that stuff worked out with you. So why don't we go through that today? And let's start with people. You know, how's your team? Did you end peak with the same people you started with? How are they feeling? I mean, you talked about crawling out of a hole in January. How'd they do? How are they feeling now? And how'd your people process go from peak?
Yeah, so luckily, we did not lose any employees during peak. Last year, I pushed the team so hard and I did a terrible job at prepping them for what we had in store. We lost a lot of people. Everyone was just like, this is way too much. So this year we really put emphasis on preparing all the employees for, like, this is what peak is going to be like.
So how many people, I mean, how many people were with you last year that were still with you this year from peak? Can you put a number on it, or a percentage of the team?
I would say a third of the team is still from last year.
So some people saw it, right? And I'm sure that helped going into this year. They had a bit of experience under their belt, so it wasn't a total surprise about what peak looked like.
Yeah, it was good in team meetings when I'm like, you know, this is what it's going to be like. You had the other guys, like my guy, like Francisco and Lito, who were there last year, who were like, you have no idea. You don't know. they were like hyping it up. So it was really good to have that, you know, that experience in the team.
That's awesome. And like, when you think about how you structured your people, you know, I know in regular operating seasons, you often have people that are focused on like special projects, you know, pick, pack, and then, or well, I guess picking and then pack and ship are kind of sometimes separate functions. What did that look like? Did you move people around for peak? Did you find that the structures that worked before peak were the same, or what does that look like?
Yeah. So one thing that most operators that I've talked to disagree with me on is I don't like hiring temps. So for me, I've actually never hired a single temp worker in the 4 years I've been operating my own warehouses. And the reason for that is I've always felt that if a temp should be used as a momentary spike in labor, and I want to give that extra work, that the money that's compensated for that extra work, to my core team. So I've come up with different ways to do that, but essentially, what we hyped the team up about, my warehouse manager actually did a funny motion, because we held, we'll talk about it a bit more, but we held these pre-peak small group sessions. And at the end of it, my general manager, Alex, would make a motion, like he's taking this big bag of money on his shoulder. And we're like, look, this is the time to make a ton of money before peak. and walk home with huge amounts of overtime. So
gotcha.
We got our core team like really hyped up and ready for that.
So the main lever was overtime for them in terms of like making more money.
It was one of the levers.
Okay.
The other lever was we do a lot of special projects in our Palm Beach warehouse. And in addition to just special projects, we use our team. We call it the prep team. So prep team is special projects and bulk shipping in one. We run it like a manufacturing line where we stage and queue up projects.
Hmm.
We run it like an assembly line. So we'll have small assembly lines, we'll have large assembly lines, whatever makes getting those orders out as efficient as possible. But what we did this year, which we did not do last year, so big learning was last year we were getting emailed, hey, can you kit this project? Can you do this special order during peak? This year we said to all of our clients in September, hey, here's a blackout period for special projects.
Hmm.
Please get them in beforehand. Even if your inventory is only going to arrive during that time, schedule it now so we can plan for it. And then we spent the last 6 months cross-training all of our employees from the prep team how to do pick and pack.
Hmm.
And they already have the hand speed that you need for packing.
Sure.
They're just missing that computer aspect, which is easy to train.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So. That's awesome. Did you get pushback from customers at all on kind of having to black out special projects for a period of time, or were they good about it?
No, they were good about it. I think what I've learned is people just want communication. They don't need, always a yes. The best, sometimes the happiest customers are when we said, hey, that's a terrible idea. Not a good plan. We're not going to do that.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. Like, you know, this has come in a few times when we chatted about how important the team is and how, you know, you've seen a lot of benefit from continuity, right? And like retaining people for a long time. It still seems so foreign. So I don't think I have a question about it, but it's more just a comment, right? Like, this is not doesn't seem like it's the typical approach, but there's enough evidence that you've seen that it works to, I mean, maybe even over invest a bit in your warehouse team, right? Relative to kind of the more traditional churn and burn model where you're putting a lot of pressure on your managers to train and ramp people up quickly to have an impact, right? So interesting to see that carried through with peak for sure. Did you onboard anybody new during peak?
A few weeks. So last year I made the mistake of hiring too early.
Hmm.
This year I waited. So the kind of the theme of this peak was communication. I told the team, hey, this is like, people don't even know peak. A lot of other warehouses that I visited during peak, the employees didn't understand what we were, that it was a special period.
Yeah.
So I really educated my team on like what it's about, why order volume goes out, you know, Christmas shopping, etc. And I told them, I said, hey, tell right now, you got parents, you got brothers, sisters, friends, cousins, neighbors that want extra work during the holiday.
Hmm.
Tell them now, here are the hours that we want to fill for supplemental labor.
Right.
And then we did an interview, we lined them up, and then we hired them to say, hey, you know, we didn't go through a temp agency. We said, hey, we're hiring extra people.
Yep.
But luckily, we haven't had to lay any of them off, and we don't plan to.
That's awesome. You know, I think what's so cool about this is, I think any brand that uses a 3PL, they're introducing a bit of risk, right? Like you're inserting a partner who hopefully you trust and have a good relationship with in between your brand and your reputation and your customer, right? And I think what's really cool about how you've been able to execute is when you have warehouse teams that are bought in and committed and doing great work, that reflects, right? It reflects in the quality of their work, which ultimately, it sounds so simple, but reflects in like how things are packed, which ultimately impacts like how customers receive it, what their unboxing experience is. So it's interesting, right? We for all the talk there is about customer experience and like, you know, staying true and loyal to your brand and being consistent through the process, I'm just reflecting on this. It's so interesting how the quality of the team that works at your 3PL and on the floor in your warehouses, even if you're running your own warehouses, is actually a pretty key part of either delighting customers or, you know, pissing them off when the product they get is damaged or the packaging sucks or it's sloppy or whatever. And I the more we talk about it, the more hard it becomes to see how you can execute well when you're counting on labor that sticks with you for 90 days and then churns and then you got to replace. So well done. I love it.
Yeah, the temps most of the time don't care. Mm-hmm. Are you a sports guy, Dan?
Big sports guy.
Okay, so think about it this way. What separates the good teams and the bad teams from winning a game? Like, what do you think the main factors are?
Yeah, I think the main factors are, you know, how they work together and how dedicated they are to their individual roles within the team.
Right. I am not a sports guy, but how I envision it in my head is you have the coach standing mm-hmm. on the bench in the locker room,
yeah,
sniping the fuck out of the team, right?
Yeah,
and it's like you've done all this preparation, they've kept all the players focused, like we're making it to the Super Bowl or the Stanley Cup, like
yeah,
focused training, and what gives you the edge, you know? I don't know. I'm not a sports guy, but I assume it's like, you know, who wants it more to some
mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
Your team has to be, you know, you got to have a solid team.
Yeah.
A well-rounded team, but it's like who wants it more? And again, knowing nothing about sports, just with this like Hollywood version in my head of what a coach does, I've tried to be that and also make my managers that and be like, guys, if you walk in for the day and be like, okay, you know, a lot of warehouses do a stand-up meeting. Okay, we have 4,000 orders in default and 200 priority orders, and we have this LTL shipment that needs to go out and this inbound. It's like, come on, let's get the team. Like, how are you going to get your employee that is capable of doing 600 orders a day or 200 orders a day? To do 600, how do you get the most out of your team? And to me, just think about it it's a sport. It's like we're the Super Bowl of shipping. This is our time to win. Like, let's get it as a team, right?
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like you know sports at least a bit. You got all the major trophies and leagues right, so well done. But I agree totally with your analogy. It brings up an interesting thought though, like why, and this would only probably work in a scenario where you have more permanent labor in your warehouse than kind of temporary or transient. But like, why not tie compensation for your warehouse teams to performance?
So really good question. I've thought about this for years. People have different opinions. Like obviously, okay, if a packer's going to do 200 or 500, I'm going to tell a packer that does 500, hey, man, I will pay you literally $50 extra a day just to hit that every day, right? But let me ask you a question. If you're compensated for being top packer, what stops you from being motivated to cut corners?
For sure.
To hit that goal?
Well,
what I've seen. That's the risk.
No, for sure. And as the question came out of my mouth, you know, I thought about people gaming the system. I guess what's interesting is if you could ever figure out a way to tie it somehow to like profitability on the customer on a longer term basis, which should control for quality, right? Like if the customer's not happy and you see the impact of that. But it is more complicated than just a volume play, because you're right, people will, you know, cherry pick the work to maximize their volume for sure.
Yeah, they cherry pick carts. They it starts to get nasty and competitive, and the packers get mad at the water spider bringing them certain carts.
Right.
Their buddies sure. Like so. I take this approach. My brother and I have been saying this for years. Legendary. You know, if you're a finance student and you graduate with a finance degree and you land a big New York private equity job, right? We call it like the Goldman Sachs summer internship. So what does that mean? You get paid decent, but on an hourly basis you're getting paid absolutely nothing because you're being grinded,
right?
And what do? They are going to push you they expect a lot. You're working ridiculous hours. But if you can hack it and stick with it, you get a guaranteed high-paying job out of college. And,
right.
You know, if you find it for a few more years, you're making, you know, 10 years later, you can make $1 million a year, right? So the way we think about warehouse labor is similarly. Like, we are a team. This is my hype talk always.
And sure.
Anyone can steal it. I'm no coach, but and I say it more refined, obviously, but I'll tell you just like the unfiltered version. My management style is twofold. I would never ask someone to do something that I couldn't do myself. So I know I made sure I can drive the forklift fast. I can unload floor loaded containers, pick, pack, everything in the warehouse.
Yeah.
And number two, we as a company are accomplishing the goal with or without any specific person. So you can either be part of our Goldman Sachs summer internship program and be rewarded for it, or you're just off the train.
Right.
So during peak, I bought the team with my own credit card lunch 3 times a week. I went to Costco and I would bring out Red Bulls and Monsters 3 times a day.
Right.
I loaded a Yeti up on a mobile cart with waters and Gatorades. And, you know, just absolutely hype the hell out of the team.
Sure.
And if someone showed that they were lazy or or were, you know, saying, oh, well, we don't get paid enough to work this hard or any of that, gone. I'm not
right. Off no, for sure. Yeah. No, I love it, man. You got to lead from the front, for sure. That's what people want. So, well done. That's awesome. Well, that's kind of first big bucket, I guess, people and how that went. Let's talk about ops and process. You know, how maybe one, this is a loaded question because I know there's a great story behind this already, but how did you change the warehouse floor and your stations to prepare and execute on peak? And maybe let's talk about that one client where you did a couple iterations of the pack flow to really optimize that, for sure. But maybe just open comments to start before we end that story.
Yeah, it's not fair, Dan. You get all the sneak peeks.
I know. Just keeping us on track.
I got to surprise you more. Yeah, I mean, I think we covered it in a previous episode, right, where last peak was, like, brutal for us. You know, customers asking for credits because of late orders. And it wasn't because we completely messed it up. It's just we were caught off guard. And, you know, when you're playing defense, we're still getting orders out, but it's like, are we missing certain orders? Did we have pallets outside when the fire inspector came? Like, all this, you know, all this crazy stuff. So, you know, this year we probably started prep in June for peak. You know, including like my dad actually uses this term. I don't know where it comes from, but he calls it technical debt. So, yep. You know, after peak, you let return slip, you let receiving slip a little bit, you let it, the warehouse get a little messy, and then you have to spend time cleaning up your technical debt. So after last peak, we started the process of clearing our technical debt, which there was a lot of.
Yeah.
And we kind of just kept that going, that philosophy going all year, making sure that our entire warehouse was cycle counted, making sure that every SKU was reviewed, whether it should be a pallet pick or in a pickable bin, how we handle overstock.
Yeah.
You know, so I think just really like having that year under our belt where we got burnt by a few things. One was the three things that burnt us last year that we focused on are queue management, which we can go into, number one. Replan and inventory issues, and then staffing and space,
right?
But we spent, and we can dive into it if you think it'd be interesting, Dan, but we basically spent all year focusing on those three things so that when peak came, we wanted it to feel like it was
That's awesome. I think we should we can probably dedicate an episode to each of those three things and unpack it more, so stay tuned on that.
dedicate a 3-day retreat on you.
Right? Yeah, seriously, maybe we'll do an in-person retreat at some point. We can deep dive on these topics. PalletSide Chat Live.
My Uline Tumblr.
That's awesome.
Not sponsored yet.
No, the true mark of an operator is Uline swag. So, let's I think one of the things I love about this story that I want to dive into now is it highlights like how critical ops and process are to just driving efficiency. I mean, obviously in peak, the pressure's on, so efficiency is even more important. But I think the lessons from this example we'll go through apply anywhere. So I'll set the stage. You keep me honest on it, and then I'll hand it over to you to walk through the details. So Alex was telling me a story about a client who is pretty high touch, right? Like custom packaging, fragile goods. And so the picking this client, for you guys isn't necessarily that complicated, but when it hits the pack station, things really start to bog down, right?
Yeah.
I don't know if you can benchmark maybe orders shipped per hour in the kind of a standard flow with this client. Do you have a rough number you could think about?
Yeah, sure. So, okay, this particular client, I believe it's 15 or 17 SKUs, one of those numbers, I forget. I think 12 or 13 of those are glass. Hmm. So those need to be bubble wrapped. So, and the orders are huge. Like their average order value is, something to be jealous of. It's sure. over $200. So when we're picking into these totes, a cart loaded with this client, first of all, is glass heavy.
Mm-hmm.
Every tote is overflowing with products, so many products. So, essentially, if you go to a normal pack station that's, small, designed for high output with all your boxes, and we have, buttons to select the box and tap to print the orders and all this, automatic label peel and present. So all this work to just get efficiency. But now this client comes to a packing station and these massive orders, that go in huge boxes that are often not at our standard packing station.
Mm-hmm.
Every single jar needs to be wrapped.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And there's no room at the packing station to do all this work. So what I saw was, as their volume like 10x literally for that month during peak, these carts are slow to pick. They'd come to the station and they would, a packer, a lot of the new packers, a really good packer would do like maybe 25. But some packers are doing 15 orders an hour.
Right.
So that's a lot of labor.
Right.
So I was like, okay, and we're talking, tens of thousands of orders a week that have to go out. So without just throwing more people at it, which, then you need more stations and more pickers, et cetera. I was like, how can we just get this out efficiently in a totally different flow? And that kind of thinking we started using for a lot of clients, and just like with this new volume during peak, how can we totally change the script and get these orders out?
Sure. So I just want to hammer one point home before you go on with how you kind of broke that process down. But the default, I think, for a lot of operators is to throw people at the problem, right? And like, let's stick to our standard process and just try to increase throughput with more labor, which is expensive, right? Like when you look at warehouse costs, rent, labor, and carrier costs are your big three. And so talk us through how you kind of flip the script a bit and avoided just throwing more people at the problem. How'd you break it down?
Yeah, so this actually happened in our West Coast facility, which had most of the problems last year too. So, it's just, the customers there are much more seasonal than they are on our East Coast facility. So it was bothering me where I'm like, okay, you have really good packers and not so good packers. A good packer can do easily 500-600 orders a day. And your average entry level, run of the mill packer during peak, let's say 200. Okay. So you're talking 2.5 times the output from a good packer. So you have that, and then we have a bunch of temps who are, we're not trained on pick and pack, who are sweeping the floor and sorting packages and doing some special projects or whatever. And I'm like, or they're thrown in a packing station with no experience and they're doing 10 orders an hour. So I'm like, that doesn't make sense. So the first thought was, okay, how do we take the trained part of picking, which is doing the tote QA, picking the right box, and, you know, handling any exemptions, mispicks, or shipping errors, to a trained packer? But then the process of simply just wrapping like 8 jars an order in a bubble bag to someone with no experience off the street, right? So that was the first thought. So what we did was we built a packing station outside of our pack line, and I called it a dispatching station. So what this person did was they would make the box, scan all of the products, so do the tote QA, get the weight on the scale, print the label, and stick it on the side of the box. But then you got a conveyor now. We just use expandable rollers. And we set up 4 stations that each just had a void fill machine, a huge box of bubble bags, and a tape machine. And all they would do is one at a time, take that box off the belt, wrap the jars, add paper, tape it up. Requires, you know, it's already tote QA'd. You're doing one at a time. It was very, very easy for us to train. And that allowed the trained packer to just get in a flow state where they were up to, I think with that V1, like 300 items an hour, you know, 60 something orders. And then, you know, they could keep, their bandwidth was just increased, and they had, you know, keeping less trained people busy down the line.
For sure. For sure. I think worth calling out here that, I mean, there was a small element of risk introduced into this that you typically want to avoid, where somebody's handling the goods after the tote QA and the scan. So it's not like you want to necessarily build an entire warehouse around this process, but I like how you called out the fact that it was kind of isolated order by order. So a person, even when they're handling it after the QA, was still just handling one order at a time. So the room for, I mean, technically a bit of maybe margin for error, but a pretty slim margin, worth the offset in throughput for sure. So
yeah, yeah. And look, not to sound cavalier, but if you're a brand that had this massive spike with 10,000 orders, the tiny risk that somehow a product doesn't go back in the right box when you're doing one at a time is so worth it.
For sure.
Increase output like that.
Totally. I mean, those are the trade-offs for peak season sometimes too, right? Is being able to manage that and hit SLAs and maintain quality, right? So that's great. Now this story, I love it because it actually gets even better. So what was that? What was V2 of this revised process like?
Yes. So I'll go into that, but first I'll say,
sorry. Yes.
Any operators listening will say, oh, you said 4 packers down the line with 1 dispatcher. First of all, it was really a 1-to-1 ratio. We got it up to maybe 2 if they were kind of slow. I ended up scaling this to, we had 2 dispatching stations and 3 packers down the line. We have to understand, you know, if we're tripling or 4 times, or we'll talk about the performance of V2, but if we're just tripling the output of a good packer, even with 2 extra people, so per person, it's the same. You can't assume that if you put those 3 people on a station doing the whole process themselves, that they would get the same results. These are people who don't know how to pack. They don't have the speed. They don't have the experience or the knowledge to work efficiently. So, you know, that's the goal. You know, that's, you're taking the simple step instead of the whole step.
Right. No, good call out for sure.
Okay. Yeah. V2.
Yeah.
Don't get too excited.
Oh, I'm pumped.
So V2 was really cool. So we actually, we ended up flying out, you know, maybe we were over prepared for peak, but we flew out 10 people at the last minute from Palm Beach over to our West Coast warehouse to assist with the spike in volume. and we still shipped every order on the East Coast within 24 hours. 95%. You know, there's always,
sure,
you know, mistakes. But yeah, so that's not sustainable, obviously. So what I started to think was, okay, it's actually cheaper for us to pay to truck half of this company's goods to the East Coast and ship orders out from there. So, you know, our warehouse in the East Coast is really efficient. It's bigger than our West Coast warehouse. And we're just, you know, we had this 10 extra people. So it made more sense to, instead of paying for hotels, et cetera, to just truck the goods and ship it from the East Coast. So V2.
Hmm.
A few issues with V1. First of all, it takes a long time to pick. So to keep one dispatcher busy required 5 pickers.
Hmm.
Literally 5 people picking at the same time just to keep up with one dispatcher. So when we had 2, you need 10 pickers. That's a lot of labor. So picking also, it requires experienced labor. So I was like, how can we do the same concept for the picking side? So V2 was this. Oh, and the other problem with V1, it was a problem for us because I was cheap with equipment. I used an old rolling belt expandable rollers that I had found, and which everyone in warehousing knows is bad for smaller boxes. So it was hard to push the box down. And like you said, more margin for error. You have, you know, 100 orders on a belt. What if one falls over and breaks? Now you don't know what it is, right?
Yeah.
Not ideal. So V2, concept of a pick wall. So what we did, and I don't know how fancy, we'll get with the editing here if we want to show you, but what we did is we built a pick wall, which was like a grocery store shelf. So instead of having the products in their cases on pallets, where you have to walk a long time, all 17 of their SKUs fit on three shelves that we made out of an old boltless shelf. And we put extra supports over the shelf to be a stopgap so the glass didn't slide off. And what we did for this is, instead of having a picker, we took another less skilled person from our prep team, or it could have been a temp, which you know, we had in the West Coast, and all their job was to do was replenish the pick wall physically. No scanners, no transfers. So what would happen is our inventory team would replen to a pallet location that we built temporarily right behind the pick wall. And everything would be keyed into that location so that we kept lot tracking. But physically, they were unboxing the cases and presenting it from the back of this pick wall like a grocery store, to make it easy on the front to pick the items.
Right.
So everything's on this 4-foot long shelf, right? And I'm really lean on equipment, so I had no more monitors or anything. And I was looking, so I was like, okay, I gotta Amazon monitors to build these new stations. Fire TVs were really cheap during the holidays. I don't know if anyone knows. So I bought 3 flat screen TVs, 55 inch, instead of monitors. They were like the same price. They're both $300. So
nice.
The reason for the monitor was, we use the ShipHero software, obviously. So in ShipHero software, you actually don't need to pick orders to a tote. If an order is not picked to a tote, you can go on the same screen and just click an order and it opens. All the items are still on the left side of the screen and you can do tote QA. So I figured if I have to wrangle this big heavy tote onto the table and then take each item and scan it and watch to make sure it's tote QA'd properly, does it really take more time if it's big on the screen to say, oh, I need SKU A and SKU B and SKU C with pictures, and then I turn to this wall and it's right there and I just grab it? So literally they would go in order and would say, okay, SKU A, grab it, scan, SKU B, grab it, scan. And they had a grocery store style scanner, which we use. The barcode orientation is way less important with that. and you're hands-free. So they have both hands. So an order would come up. Our trained dispatcher, I want to call it, because it's not a picker or a packer, it's the intermediary, would set the pace. And they would just, they're a scanner. They would scan, scan. Now, instead of the belt, I used longer assembly tables from our prep team. So the packer who was doing the bubble wrapping and the final pack out, they were on the same table. So just like a grocery store with those little dividers on the belt, the dispatcher would scan all the items and call out the box name. And we have little buttons. We set up a card with buttons in order. Mm. They would hit the button to set the box and hit print label. And then put a grocery store divider type thing. We used like pieces of scrap pallet or something. I forget. Okay. It was either pallet or like a tube from a pallet wrapping roll.
Okay.
And then the reason we did the TV is now the second person who was from our prep team, so they knew how to pack. They just didn't know how to use the computer. They would see the box that was selected, build the box, pack this order out, wrap the jars, close the box, and then we set up the label printer at the end of their line. So the packers here, the dispatchers here, all the way, 10 feet down the table, our label printers there, and they would slap the label. That setup eliminates the packer, the picker, and they were doing 500 items an hour.
It's crazy.
It was actually, Dan, it was faster than tote QAing from a tote, because you don't have to wrangle this tote.
Yeah.
They're just going. And the beautiful part too is what if those orders are big? So what if they get mispicked, right? Now you have an order locked in a tote and someone has to go fix it. For us, if we got an error, first of all, there's no mispicks because we're scanning, we don't have any, if an item comes and it's damaged because it leaked, put it in a reject pile under the table and pick a new one. There's no
right. It's crazy. It's crazy. It's such a cool case study, because when you think about the impact of that on the economics of that one client, it's significant, right? But then you think just about how that trickles down and how you can redeploy labor in your warehouse and how that impacts profitability across the board, right? It's one slow process can totally destroy efficiency, right? And so it's interesting. Cool example of kind of identifying that, extracting it from kind of your standard process and then building a tailored process to it. Obviously, you can't do that for every client in a warehouse, but I'm sure a lot of operators probably have at least one or two where it might make sense to look at blowing up a flow, and building it tailored to that client with custom pick stations or pack stations. So that's cool.
100 And since then, we've actually been using this system for many clients, and we made the pick wall on wheels. So literally, what we'll do is it's a new department where we have this, I don't know what you want to call it, pick wall station. So anything that's higher touch packouts, high volume, and not that many SKUs, but it's don't go in bulk because there's a lot of combinations. You just run it like this, swap out the cart, go.
Right. No, I like that. I guess that's the key, eh? Not a crazy SKU mix and then enough volume that justifies it.
Correct.
Yeah.
It's designed, the thinking is take a pack, like on a slow day, a packer, just take it to the station, pick packet, to keep the flow going.
Right.
But if you have the spike, release all your pickers to be able to pick the other orders and just remove literally one person, and now they can do over 100 orders an hour.
For sure. Well, right at the front of this chat today, we talked about queue management being a good topic to go into. So I think it's worth a conversation, because this is a huge part of it too, right? It's obviously managing your queue well to eliminate the bottlenecks. So that's awesome. That's a cool example. I love it.
And a helpful tip, we can put it in the comments, but if you ask your if you're using ShipHero software and ask, I forget what the code was, I would say it here, but there's a command barcode for complete order and open next order.
Mm.
So if you want to try this in your own warehouse, and you want to you know, click the first order, hit complete, open next order. The next order just pops up and you keep going. So really neat command barcode.
Nice. That's awesome. Hot tip for the ShipHero listeners. I like it. That's awesome.
I flipped when I asked. I was like, is there any way we could do this? And they're like, oh, we actually have a secret command barcode. I was like, give it to me. Awesome.
Not a secret anymore. It's out in the wild.
Oh, yeah.
Courtesy of PalletSide Chat and Alex. That's awesome. Well, hey, we're coming up on time here, but I do want to just talk quickly about carriers and how that worked for you this year as well, because obviously that's the key. When we chatted about issues, I remember you talking about last year, you know, not being able to get enough pickups in some cases and being kind of stuck there, which sucks when your team does everything right and then you just can't get stuff onto a truck and at the door. So what did that look like? How'd you pull it off this year to avoid that issue from last year?
I'll keep this one super short. And if anyone has any questions, you can leave them in the comments. But develop really good relationships with your local dispatcher. Who is the one deciding to send you a trailer or not? You know, some carriers call it line haul, some call it transport. You really want to... some carriers call it the feeder drivers. Get to know the manager of that department and prep them for what's coming. Say, hey, here's our anticipated volume. Hey, I want to help you. I don't want you sending five drivers to stand here all day as you can. I think you should send me a trailer. Have those conversations before, because we didn't do that last year, but this year I had a semi drop trailer for, which means at the end of the day, they come with an empty, take the full. I had one for every carrier, so our dock never got clogged up. We have a full Gaylord into the truck, done. We never had to worry about volume caps or anything like that. So I highly recommend, talk to your carriers, get them prepared for your volume, come up with the right solution.
The beautiful thing. How many, I mean, if people are listening and wondering kind of what kind of volume they need to do, how many Gaylords do you think you need to commit by carrier to get a truck?
Honestly, like four even.
Okay.
But put the decision to them. Be like, hey, I'm going to have, during this period, I estimate I will have 10 Gaylords a day. Would you like to send a truck to scan it, a box truck, or a pup trailer, or a 53 footer? Like, you do what you need. But all I know is I don't want any problems with my pickups.
That's great advice. That's good. I like that. Perfect. That's awesome. Cool. Before we end today, and thank you, by the way, love the teardown on how peak went. Love hearing about lessons applied based on some of the horror stories you shared with us last time. So congrats on an awesome peak. Before we wrap up today, we had one question from one of our listeners just before Christmas, I think. And she wondered about your journey with getting BlackWolf products into physical retail stores. And wondered kind of, you know, what that looked like. So maybe just give us maybe a 30,000 foot view, 30-second answer on what that looked like. And if it's a full episode, maybe we can unpack that some other time. But she was wondering what kind of some first steps would be to getting product into retail.
Sure. To be honest, I take zero credit for any retail placements we've gotten. It's not my expertise. We can bring on the people at BlackWolf who did successfully do it, but I will say, it's product market fit. Like our skincare products never had got interest from buyers, and now it's turning out a lot of the other men's skincare startups are getting dropped from retailers like Target because there's no sell through. So a lot of people focus on getting on the shelves. And I think once we started focusing on how do we move product off the shelves, drive sell through, which means how many units per week you're selling, the data that we used to determine if we'd have sell through was what helped us get into retailers. As an example, figuring out how to get TV ads to work and scaling them and showing them the success of our products on Amazon, which is a retailer. Getting in front of the particular buyers, I'm not good at that, but I know once we did, we showed them data and, said, hey, you know, here's what we're spending on media and here's our estimated sell through. And you put us in a test. And
interesting. Yeah. That's interesting. So it really, I mean, obviously there's a ton to this question, but being able to demonstrate existing scale and then probably future upside scale sounds like it's pretty important, right? If you're talking about having to demonstrate success through advertising and on multiple channels. Yeah, that makes sense. Cool. Yeah,
we're not the I'm not the viral brand marketer who built a following on social media to grow our brand. We're pure like analytic
supply
chain thinking people. So that's what we've done with retailers. Data, it's product market fit.
That's awesome. Cool. Well, hey, I appreciate your time, Alex. It's always great to catch up. Thanks again for sharing some stories and giving a really transparent behind the scenes look at what happened during peak. Appreciate it, man.
Absolutely. And we'll definitely unpack some of the horror stories that I did not share yet.
Cool.
On another episode. So look forward to that.
That's awesome. There's never a shortage of things to talk about on PalletSide Chat. Thank you again to our listeners for taking time to check this out today. Thank you for your comments and your feedback. We always appreciate it. If there's anything you want us to cover, please let us know. Drop a comment and let us know what's top of mind for you. Our plan is to spend some time this year digging more deeply into specific topics around operating a warehouse. I know we have some cool ideas and some cool guests in mind as well. So I look forward to chatting with you next time. Thanks a lot. Have a great day.